Hi, folks. That song is Lean On Me by Bill Withers, and he died March 30th. So I wasn't sure if you guys were familiar with that song, but especially during these crazy times, I'd like you to listen to that song if you have time. So today we're going to do, I'm trying to get to my lesson, chapter 20 and 21. They're super short, so we're going to do two today. And yes, you're going to have some writing assignments and things to write, so make sure you have your things with you. And let's get started. Chapter 20 is called Agendas. It was about 12:30 on Wednesday afternoon, right in the middle of Mr. Z's preparation period. He was writing short equations on the board, one for every student in his class. Mrs. Davenport appeared in the doorway of room 27 and said, "If you have a minute, I'd like you to explain something for me." Mr. Z knew that voice. He turned around and saw the principal waving a sheet of blue paper. "Sure. What's that?" he asked. She took a few steps into the room. "It's the agenda for tomorrow night's school committee meeting, and there's an item under new business. Students and faculty advisor to propose new comic book club at Ashworth Intermediate School." So remember when we left off last, you guys were working on a comic of your own, and I cannot wait to see those. And Greg and Mara were going to have to present in front of the board. So let's see what unravels with that. "Oh," said Mr. Z, "that. I hadn't heard, turn your page, anything yet. I was hoping that the school committee wouldn't even consider the request, but it looks like they did." The math teacher felt his hands begin to sweat. Mrs. Davenport said, "Let me guess. The students are Greg Kenton and Mara Shaw, and the faculty advisor is you, right?" Mr. Z nodded. "And I planned to talk to you just as soon as I found out if the committee was going to accept a presentation, because I didn't want to cause a stir. Not if it wasn't necessary." Mrs. Davenport smiled at his choice of words. She waved the blue sheet again and said, "And now it's necessary. So talk to me." "Well," said Mr. Z, "you know these two kids, both of them so smart, and they figured out," and there's a picture of them at the bottom, "that it's the school committee who sets the policy about selling things in the schools. It was right there in your announcement. And they think their little comics are as good as some of the books the kids can buy here at school from the book clubs every month. So they want to make their case. And I sort of told them I'd help. That's all." Mrs. Davenport was still smiling faintly. What does that mean? Faint, like she's fainting, or just smiling a tiny bit. "You offered to help, even though you knew my opinion about all of this?" Mr. Z said, "I didn't exactly volunteer, but when they told me what they wanted to do, I guess I decided to stay involved, to try to represent the best interests of the school." Mrs. Davenport's eyebrows went up. "Represent the best interests of the school? You didn't think I was already doing that?" Mr. Z said, "Well, not exactly." The principal's eyebrows went up a notch higher. Mr. Z had been dreading this moment, but he knew he had to say what he had to say. He gulped and went on. "I don't think there's anything wrong with the comic books, with the good ones, that is. And the ones these kids are making aren't bad, and they're definitely creative. Turn your page, please, and maybe other kids could get a chance to read them." Mrs. Davenport nodded. "I didn't know that you'd become a reading expert." There was a long, awkward pause. Mr. Z practically held his breath, afraid to guess what was coming. When it came, he was completely surprised, because Mrs. Davenport slowly shook her head from side to side and then began to chuckle. "A reading expert." Then she smiled broadly. Mr. Z began to breathe again. She said, "Well, Mr. Xenotopoulos, I thank you for your pioneering work as a reading specialist and also for keeping watch over young tycoons." Have you heard of the word tycoon before? That's a word that means someone who makes a lot of money in business. They're usually very rich. "And I'll be there tomorrow night to hear the presentation. And who knows, I just might have an agenda of my own to represent the best interest of the school." And with that, she turned and left, chuckling all the way back to her office. Let's continue, since that was a shorty. Chapter 21, page 187, the question of money. Thursday afternoon was scraping along like a glacier. Ooh, scraping along like a glacier. What are they comparing Thursday afternoon to? A glacier. So what do we call that? What kind of figurative language is that? Simile, good job. Greg looked at the clock again. Not even 4 minutes had passed. It was still almost the beginning of fifth period. Mrs. Chalmers was teaching them a new piece of music, and she was working with the sopranos first. Then came the altos, and then finally the tenors, who would get a turn. And all of those altos, tenors, they all have different tone, different levels of singing to what the degree to which they sing. So if you choose to do choir in fifth grade and sixth grade, again, you guys, if you're already in choir, you know that that's how they arrange you guys by the octave, I should say. Tonight was the night of the school committee meeting, and Gray couldn't wait. He was eager to stand up and talk to the grown-ups, a whole crowd of them. He was going to state his case. I'd be nervous, wouldn't you? He might even have an argument. The part was exciting to him. Gray was dying to see what everyone would think about the comic book. But more than that, Greg wanted the whole thing to be over, finished, settled, one way or the other. He wanted it to be over so he could think about something else, because for a solid week now, he'd been thinking about nothing but money. And during that week, money had become much more complicated. Until his big blow-up with Maura, and then his run-ons with Mr. Z and Mrs. Davenport, the question of money had been simple for Greg. In fact, it hadn't even been a question. Money was money, and money was great. It was good to make it, good to have it, good to save it, and always good to want more and more and more of it. Money? Simple. Also, Greg's attitude about money used to be private until he started trying to sell chunky comics. How he made his money and what he chose to do with it was nobody's business but his own. And tonight he was going to have to stand up in public and try to tell all those people why he ought to be allowed to sell his comics and make some money at school. It helped that Maura was on the deal, and Mr. Z too, but Greg knew that they didn't think about money the way he did. He thought he was a nutcase, a money maniac. A maniac? That's a fun word. And tonight, what if everybody else thought so too? And worse than that, what if it was actually true? Greg thought, maybe I really am a greedy little money grubber. Maybe I really don't care about anybody but myself. Ladies and gentlemen, meet Greg Kenton, the greediest, most selfish kid on earth. I like how they did that there. Greg looked at Mrs. Chalmers. She was going over and over the same 16 notes with the sopranos, smiling and nodding, playing the piano and singing along. It looked like hard work. I know she doesn't make a lot of money, he thought. None of my teachers do. And that reminded Greg of his conversation with Mr. Z about other jobs. Greg knew Mr. Z could be making tons more money if he worked for a lab or an engineering company. But instead, he was a math teacher. And that thing he'd said about his brother, the low-paid doctor, for him, enough is enough. And ever since that conversation, Greg had thought about Mr. Z's toilet theory at least four times a day. Do you remember that? And 3 days ago, Greg had heard on the, turning your page, evening news that Bill Gates, one of the richest men in the world, was giving away another $375 million for education in Africa. Super rich. And giving his money away. So you guys all know Bill Gates, Microsoft. He lives in Seattle. He's still giving billions and billions and billions away. And in the same news story, they told how Ted Turner, the man who started CNN, and that's a news station your parents might watch, had given $1 billion to the United Nations. A billion. Money thoughts had been following him everywhere, around the school, onto the soccer field, across town to his home, even into the bathroom. Greg couldn't get away from them. But if this slow-motion school day would ever end, and if tonight's school meeting would ever come, maybe that could change. So I told you those were short. So we're almost done. Three more chapters. Wow. How fun. So today, let's have a little chat here about what we got going on. Let me see my lessons if we want to do any of this. We talked about tycoon. Tycoons are very wealthy, powerful people. What conclusion can you draw about why the author uses that particular word to describe Greg and Maura? How could Greg and Maura maybe relate to tycoons? Maybe jot down a few thoughts. You can hit pause. And write down a few thoughts of why Greg and Maura, or maybe just Greg, might become a tycoon or already is a tycoon for a kid, maybe. So write some thoughts about that and then come back to me. Okay. Now, let's see. I want to skip that part. Figurative language. They want me to talk to you about that, but we've talked about that. And you guys are so good with that. And sensory details. You guys are so great. Let's talk about verbs, your favorite thing. Progressive verb tenses. So the verb be, B-E. Okay, will you write that down on your paper, please? B-E. B-E. What's the past tense of the verb be? So past tense. You wouldn't say, yesterday I be doing my schoolwork. Well, you wouldn't say that, okay, unless you were two. Then you might. So yesterday I blank doing my schoolwork. How would you change the form of the word be to past tense. Yesterday I was, okay? So past tense of the verb form be is was. I was doing my homework. What would present tense be? I am doing my homework. She is doing his homework. They are. Okay, so present tense of the verb be is, are, and am. Okay, he is, she is, I am, they are, we are. Okay, excellent. What about future? Okay, you have to add a little helper in front of them for the future of be. Tomorrow I, my schoolwork. Tomorrow I will be doing my schoolwork. Okay, so past tense is was. Present tense is, are, and am, and future is, will be. And we have talked about that. It's a reminder. Hopefully, you remember that, okay? Let's stop there. And will you do one little writing thing for me before you go, since this was a short lesson? I want you to think about, you're going to be writing a narrative about two characters that are selling something. So you can decide how much you want to do on this task today. It'll be the same for your next lesson. I want you to pick two characters. You can be one of them if you want, or you can be the narrator, third person telling about two characters. It's however you want to do that. You're going to start brainstorming some ideas of who the characters are going to be, and I want you to keep it to two main characters. You can have others in your narrative, but keep it to two main characters, okay? And they're going to be competing to sell a similar product, okay? So today, I want you to be thinking about who the characters are and what product they're going to sell. That's similar, like the comics, okay? So you can do books if you want, and they can be similar books. You can do some kind of a toy, some kind of an invention, some kind of car. Be creative, okay? So you can go as far as you want with this lesson today. So if you want to get started and set it up for us and do your introductory paragraph, that would be great. Figure out who your characters are, what they're going to be selling, where the setting is. So maybe it takes place at a school, at your house. Maybe you're competing with a sibling over something you're doing. Maybe something you're making or crafting. Okay, so what's the setting going to be? And what's the main idea you want to communicate? Like, we're going to start talking about the theme again. So the theme is the overall subject, topic, thought you want the reader to come away with. Okay, happiness, love, peace, sharing, kindness. So kind of be thinking about that. So maybe you were going to say, jot down your notes and say, today I'm going to write about me and my brother, and we're going to be competing to sell, I'll do face masks, since that seems to be what's going on with this epidemic out there. So maybe face masks. Okay. And so my central idea is that competition can make people more creative. Competition can make people work together as a team. Okay. Hopefully your two people will come to a conclusion to where they're going to maybe end up working together, but they don't have to. They could do their own, and then you could keep that theme going. Maybe they help each other, but still work on their own, but then maybe they sell them together and people buy, you know, you guys can be creative. You have great ideas. You can do the face mask idea that just came because my mom just texted me a few minutes ago and said she's going to make some face masks, and she was asking me how to do it. I told her to look online. Anyways, so get started on that, and you can write as much as you want today on this lesson. I'll have you continue with it tomorrow, and good job. And I miss you and I love you. Bye.